7 social influence principles you'll want to know. They're important. If you're in sales, I would get Robert Cialdini's book, Influence, The Science and Practice. These are where those come from, because he's done a nice job summarizing these principles and the scientific evidence for them and how they operate. Other people affect us. We may be aware of it, but oftentimes we're unaware of it. And we're profoundly influenced by other people through these social influence processes. To become aware of it allows you a certain degree of freedom from being exploited and manipulated if you are the target of it. But to become aware of it, if you're an exploiter or manipulator, will make you a much more efficient exploiter or manipulator of people, because these work. So I've been to 3 different sales events in the last year. 2 of them were car related, where I went in just expressly not to buy a car, but to get information. And another one was vacation property sold by a large corporation. And in all cases, they put on every pressure they could. But because I knew how they operated, I didn't leave feeling bad. They didn't make the sale. They couldn't believe they didn't make the sale, because they thought they had what they needed to get me to buy what they wanted me to buy. But I understand how it works. And if you understand how it works too, you can resist it. Or hopefully use it for positive, for the good, benevolently. Public health. Anybody interested in public health or medical field or anything like that? Don't you want to influence people in a positive way to increase their health and well-being? These work for that too. Charities, these work for that too. So the principles are powerful. If you understand them, you can use them. I hope you'll choose to use them for good. Reciprocity, we repay in kind that which is given to us. Sometimes we don't even like doing it, but we do it anyway. You ever have somebody offer you a favor and you turn it down just because you didn't want to owe that person? Because you didn't particularly care for them and you didn't want to owe them a favor?
Yes.
Yeah, absolutely. All right? Because there's a power to that. You do me a favor, even if I don't ask you to do me a favor, there's a power where I feel a need to repay it. It's the basis of social contract theory, if you think about it. I do for you, you do for me. You say, hey, I'll do you a favor, but you owe me one, right? There's that power behind that statement where people kind of laugh off. I help you move, man, but next time I move, you need to help me, right? And I might be laughing, but I'm serious. The next time I move, you need to help me. I helped you, you helped me. We now have a relationship. It's predictable, and we can build a society on it. It seems to be a universal thing. It's not always positive, but it largely is positive. Because if I can count on you not to kill me, you count on me not to kill you, we can now walk in safety on ETSU campus, right? But it could be that somebody does a wrong to you. What do you want to do to them? Payback, right? That's the basis of vengeance. Negative reciprocity. Somebody does harm to you, you feel compelled to do something back to them. That's how road rage happens, right? People who get in a situation where there's a lot of ambiguity, they see a behavior, they make the fundamental attribution error, they assume it's got something to do with the character of the person, they make a negative judgment about it, and then they do something that causes that person to go, hey, what the hell's wrong with that person? And all of a sudden they're going to repay that negative with a negative, and pretty soon you've got a cycle going back and forth where somebody might have just accidentally done something to begin with, and it becomes very intentional soon. So looking at the reciprocity principle, think about applications. Have you ever received or seen people in your family receive mailing labels in the mail from charities? They send you something. Why is a charity sending you mailing labels? In case you want to put them on your envelope, right? It's just a convenience. They're just being right, nice, correct? No. Research shows that by giving a small gift, you're likely to return the favor. So if a charity gives you a little token gift, you're more likely to actually donate to the charity. The Hare Krishna movement, which was well known in the 70s, wearing saffron robes and usually going without hair, pioneered this technique of getting donations by going into airports when everybody could go into airports and go anywhere they wanted to. It was a different time altogether. And they would go up to people and they would hand them a flower. This is yours, just for you. If you can make a donation, that would be great, but if not, that's fine. Now, the person receiving the flower, what are you going to do? You're going to be that asshole who's like, I don't want your stupid flower. You're going to go, thanks. And you're going to dig in the pocket and hand back a dollar or something, right? And then you know what people would do, because they didn't really want the flower. They didn't want to give money to this group of people who were, by most social standards at the time, considered quite strange. And then they found that people would go throw the flowers away. They would get a flower, make a donation, and then go throw the flower away. So they got hip to that and started giving plastic flowers. They give you a flower, you'd give a donation, you'd throw the flower away, and they'd go get it out of the trash and they'd give it away again. Efficiency. It works. Why? Because reciprocity works. It works well. If you want somebody to do something for you, one great way to ensure that happens is to do something for them. When we give something, we feel that somebody should give back to us. And when somebody gives to us, we feel obligated to return. And it's interesting because they've done some social psychological studies where they can go and do a random act of kindness for somebody and then set up a scenario. In one situation, they went into the library and they go up to people that they'd chosen randomly and they'd walk up and give them a Coca-Cola. People are like, I didn't pay for that. I mean, I don't know what to do. No, it's yours. It's yours. We're just giving things away today. They take it, right? And then the scenario is then you send a person who's actually a Confederate, a research assistant, who the person who you're looking at doesn't know is a research assistant, and they go and they drop their books and files all over the place. The people who were given a gift were more likely, statistically significantly more likely to actually help a person pick up the stuff. Stranger gives you something, you feel this obligation to return a favor, but you have no one to give it to. Somebody comes along, gives you a perfect opportunity to do a good deed, and you're more likely to do that good deed having just been the recipient of a good deed. It's interesting because it's very subtle, but it's a very powerful behavior. We like to be consistent. It's a nearly obsessive desire to appear consistent with what we've already done and said. And of course, internally, we want to be consistent with what we believe in our behavior. And that's the basis of what we looked at it the other day. Attitude and behavior being consistent. If they're inconsistent, you feel exactly cognitive dissonance. So that's the idea. Inconsistency causes discomfort. If you have a reputation, you don't want your reputation sullied, right? Because you have this appearance of being maybe an honest person or a person that can be counted on. What happens when people don't follow through with their commitments? They get labeled as what? Flighty, irresponsible, wishy-washy, a bunch of negative, pejorative terms. People don't like it when others are inconsistent. Why? We like to be able to predict things. We like to be able to predict the world and behavior. If I know you to be a certain kind of person, that's back in the personality chapter, I expect you to behave consistently across situations. But as we'll see, situations can be altered in such ways that we behave very inconsistently with what we think of ourselves and what others think of us at times. That's normal human behavior, but the consistency principle is going to underlie several of the issues we talk about shortly. Ingratiation and liking. Let's talk about liking first. Somebody asks you to do them a favor. You don't like them very much. Somebody asks you to do a favor for them and you like them a lot. Which one are you more likely to do the favor for? Person you like. We do things for people we like that we won't do for people we don't like. That's just part of our human behavioral repertoire. It makes some sense, right? You don't want to expend effort on somebody you don't care for very much, but it turns out we all want to be liked. We all want to be careful with some rare exceptions. There's always exceptions in human behavior. Some people seem to revel in not being liked, right? But what are they getting in the process? Usually a lot of attention, right? So I can get attention positively or I can get attention negatively, but I'm going to get some attention. People usually like to be liked, and they don't like it when other people don't like them. Like, why don't they like me? Why do you care? Because it's kind of wired in us. We want to be liked. I am bothered if you don't like me. I can handle it, but I'd like to know why you don't like me, right? And we don't often get the answer to that question. So the liking is a powerful thing. In fact, it's the basis of most of our relationships, right? Think about all those relationships. 50% of marriages end in divorce. Did they start out hating each other? They start out loving each other. Like you, man. I like you. Until a few letters, I hate you. I hate you. But what happened in the middle? Life happened in the middle, right? Liking probably allowed them in the first stage of the relationship to overlook a lot of their own issues and overlook a lot of issues they had with other people. And as familiarity set in, you had to reckon with realities. And realities weren't nearly as fantasy-based as you might have hoped they were, right? And then you're going to have to like somebody for who they really are, not for who you wish they would be, or it's not going to work very well. But ingratiation is a motivated attempt to make somebody like you with the idea that you'll get something in return later. Classic brown-nosing, ass-kissing, right? Superficial compliments given to somebody where others seeing this behavior go, man, they don't mean that. I can tell that's just some bullshit. They're just saying that. They don't feel that. So why do people do that? Why would they engage in superficial complimentary behaviors? Because it works. It works. When looked at objectively and scientifically, people who are the targets of ingratiation, bosses, managers, etc., tend to give the raises and promotions to the people who ingratiate more. Not everybody, on average. Even if they know it's ingratiation. Even if they know it's insincere. Wow, you would think, well, if I knew you were being insincere, I would never favor you later. But that insincerity is still registered as what? A positive coming at me. And now I kind of owe you for treating me so well. It's time to do you a solid, and I'm more likely to do it. And I'm more likely to like you because you keep professing to like me, even if you don't. Scarcity. Opportunities seem more valuable when they're less available. That is the essence of economy, really. Supply and demand. If there's a lot of supply and no demand, right? Things are cheap if not free. But what if there's a lot of demand and no supply? Then almost anything takes on value. Beanie Babies. Y'all know Beanie Babies are expensive? Barbie dolls can be really expensive. Stamps. Pieces of paper that big can become really expensive. Baseball cards. What's a baseball card really worth? The paper it's printed on. It's a picture and some statistics on a little card. And if you buy them in bulk, new, they are cheap, relatively speaking. But if you've got a mint condition Babe Ruth rookie card, you're sitting on a fortune. Because why? There's just not that many of them around. The lack of the supply and there being any demand whatsoever increases the perceived value. That's the social influence part of it. It's a perceived value. One of the examples in Cialdini's book of this idea was a jewelry store, I think it was in New Mexico or Arizona, where turquoise is plentiful. And they had a display of some jewelry that had not sold for a long, long time. The owners were leaving the store and instructed the staff to mark it down dramatically. Some miscommunication occurred and they marked it up dramatically. And it sold that weekend. Did the value of the actual objective material change? No, the perceived value, because it was so expensive, it must be really good. So that's interesting, right? So you can see how just manipulating ideas. How about one day only sales? How about McRib for a limited time only? Or Barbie dog for a limited time only? You better get it before it's gone, because it's a scarce opportunity. It conveys a sense of urgency and value. And then we got novelty. People like new things. Now, keep in mind, people vary on these principles to the degree that they will engage in reciprocity, to the degree that they'll engage in consistency, to the degree that they would ingratiate or feel needed. Need to be liked, to the degree that they are motivated by one day only kinds of things, or limited time only, or I need this particular item. And novelty, I'm relatively low in novelty. I eat the same shit all the time. If we ate pizza every day, I'd be all right with that. Other people are like, man, I had pizza last night. I can't have it again tonight. I'm like, why not? I need something else. I need something different. I already did that. I need something new. And that's interesting, because this novelty idea works in sales. What is it called? New and improved. Why do you say new and improved? Why do you put that in big, bold labeling on your product? Because it's novel. It's neat. It's new. Maybe I should take a second look. Y'all remember, I don't know how old... Ages change. I'm getting old. I'm going to be an old man and die one day. That's going to be all right, I think. Everybody else does it. I'm sure I'll get used to it. There was a time when Heinz sold green ketchup. Do y'all remember green ketchup? All right, some of y'all were little then, right? Green ketchup was something nobody had ever seen before. And you know what happened to sales? Woo! It went through the roof. Sales of green ketchup. Now, you know what green ketchup tastes like? Red ketchup. Because it's food coloring. You know what red ketchup's actually made of? Food coloring. Tomatoes ain't that red, right? What's in ketchup?
Vinegar.
Red number 5. I don't know, perhaps vinegar. But I'm talking about the dye of the color of the thing, right? The actual variable that changes it from red to green. All you could put, and then they actually came out with what? Purple ketchup. Before what? People realized it was just ketchup and they stopped buying it. And they went back to buying what? Red ketchup. Why? It's what they're used to. Red ketchup seems more natural because it's the color, theoretically, of tomatoes. Even though the actual color of ketchup is artificial. And that's the novelty effect, right? It's this new thing. And people sometimes like to try new things, and they'll try them, their behavior is affected. Because nobody's done it, then they get what? Conversations going, have you tried that? Movies have exactly that effect. Brand new movies that come out, when do they sell the most tickets?
Opening night.
The first week that they're open. Because they're what?
New.
No! The new movie's out. Did you see the new movie? A month later, you're like, I saw that movie. You're like, I saw that movie a month ago. That movie ain't, there's new movies out now, right? It's old hat and people let it go.